We are having with us a very renowned and great personality with us today to give a popular lecture, and he is going to enlighten us on artificial intelligence. I will just brief about Brajesh Pandeji, sir. Actually, now I request Brajesh Pandeji is with all of us for past 2 days. He is with us, and we are very well aware, Dr. Brajesh Pandeji. Whenever he is, but for the 2 days, you seen that whenever he is introducing that guest, he is saying that yeah, sir is having like this award, that award, and he is from IIT, this, that, like that. But we don't know about who is Brajesh Pandeji. Brajesh Pandeji actually is he completed his PhD from IIT Kanpur, and he is very well known for his science popularization, and he is associated with Vijayan Bharati, and mostly he is science popularization is his, one of his dream project work also. And for this, recently he has been awarded with Dr. Vikram Sarabhai National Award also for popularizing of science. So anyway, we are going to have with him tomorrow for nearly 1 to 1.5 hours. He is going to demonstrate us simple physics demonstrations. So I will brief about him tomorrow. Now I welcome Dr. Brajesh Pandeji to invite our honorable chief guest to invite this session. Brajesh Pandeji, sir, over to you.
Thank you, Sudhakar ji. I am really very happy and privileged to introduce Professor Ketan Kotecha for this session. Dear student, teacher participants, and other participants of this country, and I know many of the participants, those who are logging to IISF 2020 website, they are directing to this site and they are watching our program, because this we have advertised there, that is popular lecture on AI, and many people are interested in just listening and learning what is AI. That is the basic and fundamental things about the AI. So today we have for this popular lecture Professor Ketan Kotecha. I will just briefly read out, tell about him, so that, because there are so many participants are there, and that should know that what kind of people we have in our country for popularizing different subject and different things. So Professor Kotecha is an advocate and practitioner of emotional intelligence at workplace. Dr. Kotecha is at the helm of his administrative, academic, and entrepreneurship affairs of the Symbiosis International Deemed University. He is an alumni of IIT Bombay, a professor of computer science and engineering, head of Symbiosis Center of Applied Artificial Intelligence, dean faculty of engineering at Symbiosis International Deemed University, and he is director, Symbiosis Center of Technology, chief executive officer of Symbiosis Center of Entrepreneurship and Innovation. Dr. Kotecha is the recipient of very prestigious international grant like Erasmus Faculty Mobility Grant from European Union, LEAP Grant from MHRD Government of India to visit University of Cambridge, UK, DO India Professor Fellowship to Brunel University, UK. He also received 2 Spark Grant worth 1.6 crore from MHRD to carry out research in collaboration with Arizona State University, USA, and University of Queensland, Australia. Embassy of United States of America invited Professor Kotecha to participate in US-India Higher Education Collaboration Workshop for establishing international partnership for research and academic collaboration with India and USA. His 25 years of extraordinary career saw him serving in the finest of the engineering college in the various in higher technical education leadership position. And as researcher, he has various prestigious transitional projects under him. Dr. Kotecha was keynote speaker for events such as ACMA Technology Summit 2019 Pune, International Conference on Flexible Learning Pathways arranged by United Nations at Vietnam, Artificial Intelligence and Data energetic in decision making at the 14th FICCI Higher Education Summit. He was also a member of FICCI Higher Education Delegation to South Korea and also deputed in delegation to visit Canada by Government of Gujarat. He has also delivered a talk on research direction for artificial intelligence at various forums, including at his alma mater, IIT Bombay. He has more than 100 papers published, presented in international conference around the world. To his credit, 3 patents is filed. He is guided and guided several PhD students working on various fields of computer science and especially in machine learning. His insightful article on various varying topics are also published in News Daily. Dr. Kotesa was founding provost of Gujarat largest private university, Parul University. He was director, academic development and research, Shell Nirma University, Ahmedabad, where he also served as the dean and director of the Institute of Technology, Nirma University. He was a visiting expert of university at Pretoria, South Africa. He was also invited and visited various countries like USA, Canada, UK, Singapore, Hong Kong, South Africa, Spain, Poland, Germany, Czech Republic, Switzerland, Argentina, China, Vietnam, and South Korea. This is just short introduction of his from his CV. I would like now request Professor Kotesa to please address my student or teachers, those who are here. Sir, at the same time, I will give the chance to my audience that they can write the question in question answer. We will take some of the question at the last. The relevant question we will at the last. Sir, please.
Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks, Dr. Brajesh, for a very detailed introduction. And thanks the organizers, including Dr. Sudhakar, Dr. Ayas, and Dr. Pandey, for giving me the opportunity to share my views here with the students. Let me also add that in the profile of Brajesh, that he is an extraordinary counselor for the students. So I'm sure you should grab the opportunity once he's interacting with you. He's counseling my 2,000 plus students here at my institute. So let me quickly start sharing my screen and tell you something about artificial intelligence. I'm sure it is visible now, Vijesh.
Yes, sir, it is visible. Yes.
Yeah. So, the difficulty today for me is I need to explain to a few thousand students about artificial intelligence in less than 1 hour of time. Right. So, what I have done now is I'll be introducing you the definition of artificial intelligence. What is it? But always any first lecture of any subject, I'm sure it should be motivating, or it should rather create the curiosity among the students. So what I'll do is I will give a large number of applications where artificial intelligence is used nowadays in day-to-day life, maybe various and diverse applications, so that you will like the subject. And I'm sure that once the person likes the subject, he or she will go to Google, go to the teacher, learn, and even apply, right? So that's the goal today, where you expect a little bit of definition and introduction of AI, but then majority of my talk will be on applications of artificial intelligence in day-to-day life. So I just, there's a disclaimer where the material I have collected from various sources to just give you the idea about artificial intelligence. Everyone, in the society right now feels that AI is new. AI is like 21st century's phenomena. But it is not true. AI is there in existence since 1950, right? So almost 70 years back, AI was born. And after that, after 1980, that AI has changed to something called machine learning. I'll be giving you some definition of AI, machine learning as well. And after 2010, something has again happened, and that's what it has been converted into deep learning. So all the magics which we are seeing right now of AI They are because of deep learning, actually, which is a branch of artificial intelligence. Right. So I'll be giving you the definition, but why this transition has happened? Because in 1950, it was AI. Then, you know, machine started learning itself. And that is a new era where powerful machines were discovered from 1980 onwards. And that machine learning has come. And after that, you know, a lot of data is getting generated. Now, everywhere there's a huge amount of data. For example, earlier there were no malls. And that's why transactions of the users were not known. That I go to mall and what are the things I buy? You go to the mall and which are the things you buy? There was no record before maybe 2000 or 2010. But now because of that, there are records and data are available. And also the computers have become very, very fast now in after 2010. So because of both of this, faster computer and large amount of data available, the deep learning has born, and that has created a lot of magics, I would say, in the society. So you'll see some of the magics and some of the applications where deep learning is working fantastically right now and making our life more pleasurable. These are some of the applications I have listed. I'm telling some of the applications where artificial intelligence is used right now. If I start with on this side, entire banking industry is not only automated, but also uses artificial intelligence. I give just one example whereby if I have a credit card and if I'm doing some transactions, maybe every now and then, let's say 10,000 rupees, you try to do transaction of, let's say 1 lakh rupees or more, immediately there'll be an alert from the bank. It will not alert you. If you are not doing international transactions every day, but if you do it one day, it will not allow. Just because AI will find out that there is something wrong here, right? So this kind of applications are available in the banking front. In transportation, there is an, you know, now the transportations, all the vehicles are getting connected to each other. They talk to each other. And, you know that traffic is known in real time. If you want to travel from one part of the city to another part of the city, you can pre-decide that, you should go on another path because there's a huge traffic jam somewhere. So all these things are, possible because of artificial intelligence. In case of education or retail spaces, there's a huge amount of AI. For example, right now we are conducting the examination of the students or entrance test of the students, whereby computer and AI algorithm decides if student is trying to cheat during the examination. So algorithm automatically alerts that student is seeing outside the screen or is talking to someone. So everything is now possible to decide because of artificial intelligence. In communication, your email, even if you're replying to email, you can give a smart answers automatically. So that is artificial intelligence. I'm sure most of you must be addicted to games. So games are the classical example of artificial intelligence where computer is playing against you. So you can imagine that how better the algorithm can be, AI algorithm can be. In media industry, I'm sure you have seen the movies without any human beings, totally animated. So that is again artificial intelligence. So I can go on giving a lot of examples here. I've just covered on one side, but you can see there are all kinds of industries or all kinds of areas in the society where artificial intelligence is used. Even in sports, I am not sure that you know, recently our great past cricketer Anil Kumble has started some particular training startup whereby AI based algorithm teaches how to play best cricket, like maybe Tendulkar or maybe Sehwag or maybe any other player. So there is an AI algorithm which teaches you automatically. So training coach using AI here started. Online shopping, I'm sure most of you must be doing that. Lot of healthcare industries uses artificial intelligence. I'll be giving you a couple of examples of that. Agriculture university, there's a huge amount of AI used, even for finding out that now this crop is ready, or this particular crop requires some kind of fertilizers. So all these things are possible to now predict and decide a priori. in real estate, you may not go and see the actual site of a house, but you can see it remotely, maybe in a 3D as well. Maybe you can walk in inside the house on a computer. So all these kind of things are possible. Social networks, I'm sure in my days I was using Facebook, but I think you are on Insta, maybe Snapchat and whatnot. So all this, how the recommendations are given, friends, this is your friend, and you get a recommendation for a new friend. So all these things are controlled right now by, you know, artificial intelligence. Defense, there's a heavy use of artificial intelligence in surveillance camera and so many other applications, unmanned vehicles as well, with no human beings, but autonomous vehicle will fight against the terrorist. Right? Now the homes are becoming smart. There's a lot of smartness in the home. Your refrigerator can be smart, your TV can be smart. So all this smart means definitely there is some substance of artificial intelligence there. In politics, I'm sure you know, long, long back, even the Obama won the US president based on a lot of, you know, social media, usage of social media. And so it means that in politics and also in e-governance, the artificial intelligence is used. Some of the things I have skipped here, but you know, my point here is that AI is everywhere, right? So I always tell to the students that whatever the profession you select in future, you become engineer, you become scientist, you become maybe a designer, you become maybe a music artist, maybe a sports person, you need to know little bit of AI, because in future, those who are using AI will replace those who are not, right? So for example, I always tell that the teachers, you know, will not be replaced by technology, but the teachers, those who are using AI, will replace the teachers, those who are not using AI. So it's like AI is an integral part now of the society. And I am sure because of that reason only, the central government and state governments are now teaching AI from, I think, 8th standard onwards, particularly in CBSE and other such schools as well. So what is this? This AI is creating a magic in the society, and it's a buzzword. I'm sure every other person knows at least what is AI, in the sense they feel that AI is doing something, right? So let me introduce on a formal way what is artificial intelligence in just one slide. So AI is a broad term, as I'm sure you know this particular symbol. This is, AI is a broad term. And by definition, it's a technique that enable machines to solve the task the way in which human do. It means whatever the tasks we are doing, if some of the tasks are solved by a machine, then we can tell that machine is having AI. As simple as that. Any simple example you take, if you can do and machine is also doing similar tasks, it means machine is having some AI, some IQ is being developed. And it is an artificial IQ, and that's what it is, AI, right? After artificial intelligence, you know, next term is machine learning. Now, imagine that you studied, maybe you are a 10th or 12th or 10 plus 2 student right now. You studied to some level and you demonstrate some IQ in a particular situation. You take some particular decision. For example, you take a decision of becoming and taking science as a stream and becoming scientist. Right. After a few years, based on your decision, you will get some, you know, results that your scientist decision was correct or not. So based on your decision and based on correctness of the decision, rather success or failure of a decision, you will learn something more. And that's called machine learning. See, human beings are demonstrating some intelligence. And while demonstrating, they take some decision. And after a few years of taking that decision, they realize that decision was good or bad. And based on that, they learn further, right? So ultimately, we tell in our, you know, psychological, you know, definition, we consider that wisdom, you know, finally person developed the wisdom, right? And similar phenomena, if machine can also do, of course, not at the level of wisdom, but if machine can also learn while performing, that is called machine learning, right? And that's, as I mentioned, that 1980 onwards, that was very popular. There is a one more terminology always, and that is artificial intelligence, which is, or artificial neural network rather, which is like, there is a network of structure, which is like same as brain, right? The way in which brain learns, if your computer structure also learns, it is called artificial neural network. And the last terminology is deep learning, which is again a subset of machine learning. But as I mentioned when I started, that, you know, it is very, very, you know, data centric, rather data hungry, I would say, that a huge amount of data is available. And if huge amount of computational power is available, then you can do deep learning, right? At you know, layman's language, if I want to explain what is difference between machine learning and deep learning, in machine learning, I need to ask computer what I want from computer and how computer should do that. Both what and how. But in case of deep learning, I need to only ask computer what I want. How is not to be specified, right? So it is same as your mom is telling that beta ye kar do, but mom is also telling that aise karo. So I'm sure that aise karo nobody likes. So that is deep learning, where you need not to specify how you do it, you will do it, right? Mom bolti hai ki bacha padhai karo 10 ghanta and grade lao. What you will tell? Mama, grade aa jayenge, hame padhai mein apni taraf se. Any of the algorithms inside, right? So that is deep learning. So I'm sure a lot of terminologies, and as I started with, it's not going to be that easy to understand all the terminologies today, but some of the applications and some of the terminologies in a broader way you should know, right? So this actually I tried to explain the difference. Now there are three kinds of learning in machine learning or artificial intelligence. One is called supervised learning. So only these 3-4 slides are theory. After that, there are full of applications. So one is supervised learning. So how it works? This is a computer. To computer, you give these images, let's say apple, and also you tell they are apples to computers, right? So there are three, it may be 300, right? After that, machine knows what is apple. So if you give a new apple, it will tell it's an apple. So there was a training phase, there was a teacher here which tells this is apple. So it's a supervised learning. Like if your teacher is teaching in the classroom, it is a supervised learning, right? That is one kind of learning. So you can teach the machine like you can teach to the human being with examples, right? And that is supervised learning. Second is unsupervised learning. See, for example, right now I'm not teaching you in the classroom. You are just listening to me, or you can also play a video. Maybe from online Google, you go to Google, YouTube, and you play some video of science or artificial intelligence or anything. But then also you can learn, even though teacher is not present online with you. Then also you can learn from the video, and that is unsupervised learning, whereby there is no teacher. You see, there is no one who tells me that this is apple and this is another fruit. Right, but then also machine can classify based on the similarity and dissimilarity of the patterns, that these four looks similar, so they are in one class. These two looks similar, so they are in one class. And this, you know, three looks similar, so they are in different class. So this is also a learning here, where patterns are found. And that is called unsupervised learning, where teacher is not present, okay, but machine learns automatically by differentiating or finding the similarity between the patterns. And the third kind of learning, which is very advanced and which is called reinforced learning, which is learning based on success and failures, or based on mistakes. For example, you give computer this particular picture and you ask, is it mango? The answer is no. And answer also tells that it is apple. So now computer learns that this is apple. And next time, if you give that apple, it will tell it's an apple. So it is learning based on experience, right? So all these three learning, the next slide will make you very, very clear. This is supervised learning, where mom is teaching to a kid, this is alphabet, this is zebra, or this is elephant, and continuously several times. It's not that one image of elephant will make this child know what is elephant. Several such pictures, several such variations needs to be shown. So that is called supervised learning. Unsupervised learning, ideally it is best. A kid is reading himself or herself, reading a book. You see, you can imagine that this is a difficult kind of learning, right? Maybe ideally you should have this first and then followed by this. So this is unsupervised learning, right? And reinforcement learning, this is the classical example. I'm sure nobody will forget once I'll give this example. That this particular kid wants to walk. Now, what is the way? Only way is kid needs to try and fail several times. Several times the mother sets the goal that come closer. Slowly and slowly mother increases the goal and the kid runs fine. Not only walks, but it runs also. So it is after several success and failure, the kid learns that. If you want to learn swimming, then also you need to do this. You need to jump into a swimming pool. You cannot read a book like this or this to learn swimming. So that's an example here, right? So this is the difference between three kinds of learning, which is very popular in artificial intelligence: supervised learning, unsupervised learning, and reinforced learning. Only these are some of the only few concepts. If you learn, you can become even master of artificial intelligence. But of course, there's a lot of detailing behind this and a lot of mathematics behind it. And there is a very advanced deep learning algorithms, which is very difficult for right now to understand. There are three categories. One is convolutional neural network, one is recurrent neural network, and third, generative adversarial networks. I'll just quickly go to the examples without giving any definitions of them. If you use convolutional neural network, you can do this. Given a camera live, you can find out car. Maybe you can find out even a number plate, which I have not shown here. Okay, and number plate can map to some other database. So you'll find out that this particular car is registered in Jammu Kashmir, or this particular car is registered in maybe Gujarat somewhere. So it's possible to find out. And you can also find out a person. You can also find out that person is wearing a mask or not. All such. If I give a small example here, that any machine, let's say in Maruti Udyog, there are a lot of machines producing a lot of cars every day. But one part goes wrong one day, then the entire production will be at halt for several days. What AI can do is AI can a priori means tell that after 3 days, this part may go wrong. So before 3 days, you get an alert, or before X days, you get an alert, and you can maintain that particular part so that entire machinery will not stop and your plant will not be at fault. So tremendous advantage here. And you can imagine there are thousands and thousands of industries where if you use AI like this, then you can do predictive maintenance. So before, let's say at your home, before your aqua guard or before your water filter goes bad, you know before 3-4 days that it's going to go bad. So you can call a service person and get it serviced. Okay. So that is definitely possible in any of this, fabrication or manufacturing industries. Even a small example I'm giving in manufacturing industry is if you want to design Formula F1 car, automatically machine generates the design where it will go very fast. It is fuel efficient, energy efficient. So all this parameters you need to give it to AI algorithm, and AI can generate an entire structure of a car for you. You need not to design at all, and that kind of generative designs are possible. AI is used in healthcare as well. If your nurse cannot come to your home, you can have a virtual nurse which will do almost 90% of the work which actual nurse can do. That is now possible. Right. And there are so many predictive analysis is possible. I have a couple of examples from Google in the next few slides, next couple of slides. But tremendous advantage right now, and a lot of progress of healthcare right now, healthcare services right now, is because of artificial intelligence. One example, if I give here, Google has developed this particular technology whereby a single photograph of your iris is taken, and you can find out everything about a person. You can find out age of a person, sex of a person, smoking habits of a person, BMI of a person, so many things. Just retina scan, right, in 5 seconds. So that is available now, and it is definitely only artificial intelligence. Robots are doing surgery. Okay, you know this company, right? Because I'm sure the brand means youngsters know all the brands more than me. So this Porsche company, is a car maker, but now they are into venturing into automatic surgery done by robots completely, right? And you see what is the accuracy rate. Right, so it means in healthcare, it's going to be a great advantage of using artificial intelligence in future. Your wearable devices, they use artificial intelligence to give you a lot of guidance. This is a project from Stanford University. I'm sure at least you heard the name of the university, which is number one engineering university in the world. They are using machine learning to predict solar flares. Right. So those, I'm trying to give you very diverse applications so that if you're interested in one particular area, suppose you're interested in geology, then I can tell that ONGC also uses AI since several years, in fact, to find out oil somewhere, right? So if you're using in textile industry or nanotechnology industry or some other industries, then, again, AI is used to find out and help that particular industry. So there are diverse applications of artificial intelligence every corner of the society. Amazing, right? There is a band, it's completely by AI robots. Right? So I'm not putting something, which is hypothetical. These are all in existence. We are not only manufacturing-driven country, but definitely our majority of the GDP is GDP is based on agriculture. If there's a good rain, like the entire country flourishes. If not, there are a lot of issues, right? So it means there's a very powerful agriculture, system we have. And in agriculture, there's a maximum use of AI right now. As I was telling that in crop classification, that crop is bad or not, crop yield, crop is having disease or it will have a disease in future if you are not using this pesticides right now. All these things are possible to find. Crop is ready or not, health monitoring of the crop, irrigation schedule, this is very simple in fact now, everything is possible to manage using artificial intelligence. Right? So there's a huge, huge use of AI in agriculture as well. Some of the applications which are unbelievable, this particular, whatever is written here, is written by a computer. And it is somebody's handwriting. So AI can learn your handwriting and it can write as well. Only this thing I can tell. I can't explain the algorithm. And if you want to know more about that, it is done by University of Toronto. There's a person called Alex Graves. That are his handwriting written by computer. So it's not the text, which you know that on WhatsApp also you speak and computer types. But that is not the handwriting of any human being, right? But this is handwriting of a human, which has been captured, right? So it means your signature on the check also can be done by computer now. I'm sure you're using Gmail, and once you use it on mobile, and now of course on desktop also, there are three replies at the below. There are three possible replies. You can click them, one of them, and it goes, right? So that's suggestions are also coming from artificial intelligence algorithms, right? And they are customized suggestions. They are not the standard suggestions. They are customized based on what you want to type. It is based on your test, right? So that is also an application of artificial intelligence. Most favorite, I'm sure, for all of us, not only you, for me as well, the games. And that game design is, solely because of artificial intelligence. If I want to find out your facial expressions, if you are in a classroom, unfortunately you are not right now, But if there is a classroom of 60 students, and if I'm delivering a class, and if I want to analyze that how many students were happy, how many were depressed, how many were angry on me, I can find out. I can take a video and I can use AI algorithm, and I can find out that 30% of the students were sad in my classroom, maybe 40% of them were enjoying my classroom, and others were like no expressions, right? So I can find out that, and that is possible using artificial intelligence. I'm sure these are my favorite characters for all of you, and there are movies on this, but these are all the characters were artificially created by artificial intelligence. You see, you cannot download a photograph from Google and put it in a movie. Then it's a copyright violation. You need to create an indigenous photograph, which is not existence in Google, as well as the kids like them, right? You like this kind of photographs, and that's what it has been created. And that is created by only computer. Nobody has, no artist has designed them. It has been created by Carnegie Mellon University long, long back in 2007. This is also possible using now computer. You give this picture to the computer and you ask computer, where is this giraffe? And computer replies, in the grass. You see, for us, we take maybe 3 to 4 years of time, or it is 5 years of time before start giving this kind of answers, but computer can do in no time. That is the progress of artificial intelligence now. There are some more pictures I have for next 10 minutes maybe, then we can have a question answer. People have designed, researchers have designed, you know, this particular fork, which is AI-based fork. It will track your eating habits. Of course, you need to use this fork while eating maybe spaghetti or maybe noodles. And it will track everything. How fast you eat, how much you eat, maybe. And if it can be enhanced, how much calories you've taken, right? So all these things can be monitored and recorded. So that is available. Whatever the pictures I'm showing now, these are all the products available in the market. May not be only in Indian market, but they are available and they use artificial intelligence. Smart toothbrush. So how much you are doing? Most of us, in fact, don't know how to brush actually. It should be vertical or horizontal, and how much of time. So this brush will note that and it will guide you. That your brushing habits are not good, or you are not doing twice every day before going to bed and after bed you should be doing. So all these things are monitored and a counseling is done. So that is available. So if you are very interested in plants which are in-house, okay, without sun it will grow. And if you want to monitor what are the needs of that plant, what is required, which chemical is required, how frequently it is required, which temperature it should be. Everything can be controlled and monitored using this particular system from mobile. If you want to control your sprinkler from your cell phone, it is possible now. This is very, very important now. From remote location, anywhere else you are in the world, you can monitor your home is secure or not. There are a lot of sensors you can put in the home. And if anyone comes inside your home, anyone tries to break your lock of a home, or anyone enters from some other place from the home and trying to move inside the home, you can get an alert on your cell phone, wherever you are, right? So that is available. You can even see this application, even you can see the video. This is a classical, you know, invention where swing analyzer. So if you are playing this game, I'm sure this is one of the very good games, and you may not be playing, but you like this to watch in the sports channel. And how fast you are swinging your bat can be recorded, and based on that, it teaches the player that you should be using, and you should be doing like this. You should be hitting the bat like this, with this much force maybe. So all these things are saved and analyzed, and then guidance is available on that. This I'm sure we are using based on our Fitbit, that how good your sleep was, right? Maybe you should sleep for 7 hours, or maybe on corona days because you're using a lot of screen, maybe you have to sleep for 8 hours. So all these things are noted automatically by your cell phone. You can have a smart cooker which adjusts the temperature on off everything automatically based on the need. Right. So I'm sure you also know that smart washing machine where it takes the amount of, you know, detergent powder based on the, you know, how much is required, what is the amount of clothes inside and how much dirt inside the clothes. So everything is calculated by AI and it takes that kind of detergent. This is also a very indigenous, you know, invention and is available, a smart tennis racket, which, you know, records everything once you play tennis. It records everything on your, you know, cell phone and finally guides you that this particular stroke was not okay and this particular movement was not okay, this much force was not okay. So everything you can learn after you play that, right? So next time you won't make that kind of mistakes. Smart bike, which you can read, it can give you directions, which now is very popular, GPS, right? So on a bike, so GPS is also an example of artificial intelligence. Smart door lock, anyone tries to tamper with your lock, you will get an alert wherever you are. Smart socks, they have a sensor, and they will calculate everything, your calories as well, how much distance you travel, which altitude you went, so everything. So I can go on giving that, all these things, but I thought let me stop. We'll have some room for the question answer as well. So maybe I'll do a couple of slides and stop. So this is a smart, you know, shirt, which monitors how your body behaves over a time. It also measures the heart rate so that you can improve your health, right? So this is in online, it is possible. The t-shirt is wearing itself is a smart t-shirt, right? So I can go on giving hundreds of examples, but I thought we will have some more question answer here, and that's what I should stop. Before that, you know, let me tell you, this person, Andrew Ng, he is founder of Google, right? He is one of the founders of Google, means he works at Google. He works at Stanford University as well. He was working rather. And Coursera, I'm sure everyone has heard, there's something called Coursera where you can learn on video lectures. He's a co-founder of that as well. What he has told, artificial intelligence will transform every industry, just as electricity did 100 years ago. So you can imagine without electricity, what will be your life? So same thing will happen without AI, right? Between now and 2030, it means there's a huge, huge scope for at least next 10 years to jump into AI, learn AI and implement and apply AI, right? And it will create 13 trillion GDP growth, $13 trillion GDP growth, right? So that is his statement. And let me also add that don't have a fear that if AI is doing all these things, what you will do, right? In fact, there are hundreds of things where AI will not be able to surpass us. But for example, common sense will be always better. In emotional intelligence, possibly will be always better. In negotiating, influencing people, having a deal with someone, clinching a deal, everywhere we will be always superior to them, superior to AI algorithms and computers. And there are several other things where AI will be better. For example, in healthcare, maybe a surgery done by that, robots. So several other cases where AI will be superior. So the best thing is you get married with AI, in the sense you use your IQ and EQ and common sense, also use AI for solving the particular application. What I'm trying to tell is in 21st century, it's a century of collaboration with others and collaboration with AI as well, right? So you don't leave some particular problem which can be solved using only AI, or also don't solve the problem without AI. One has to use human beings as well as AI together and solve particular problem. And the last, you know, again, because there are a lot of, you know, questions I'm sure will be in your mind, again, about replacing you by AI. You see, before 20, 30, 40 years, when computers were invented and computers were, you know, applied in the banks, everyone was feeling that no person will be required in the bank because bank is doing everything. Computer is doing everything, right? For example, ATM and everything. But now, as of now also, there are maximum opportunities in banks and financial sector. Does not mean that, you know, AI has replaced human beings, but now it is in collaboration. So AI and human beings should work in close connection and solve the application, and that is going to be the future, right? So like Microsoft Word or some particular editor, everyone should learn because they are a handy tool. AI is a tool, right? So you need to learn that tool and apply in any of the discipline. From this particular talk, I'm sure that you got an idea that if you want to do in agriculture, or if you want to be a musician, or if you want to be a doctor or anything else, if you use AI, you can do better. Right? So thanks. Thanks for listening to me, and thanks to the organizers of ISF for giving me this opportunity to interact with young budding minds here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for this nice introductory talk, I can say. And in fact, throughout this whole session, I have even switched off my phone and I was trying to listen each and every word. And actually, I learned a lot today from this artificial intelligence basic lecture. And the student has also learned. Their question says that, yes, they have a lot of questions. And since the question only comes when we are learning something, if you are not learning something, there is no question. So their question, I'm really very happy that at the last, you have answered some of the question nicely. And maybe this is your experience, because whenever you are giving this talk, people have a lot of questions that is tomorrow artificial intelligence will come. How the job and other things will be there. So some of the question of that type. And so few question, if you just allow, I will ask few of the question, and then we will again cover up this talk, because this is really a very nice talk from my side. And I understand that my student, they are also writing in comment box and other places that this talk is really, really very helpful for them to in world, because this particular platform Science Village is to promote for the science. Here we are promoting another computer science. This is also, I consider, not engineering, it is science. There's a lot of sciences there. And once science develops, technology will automatically come out of that. Yes. So here, this in the another fourth category of the science, I can say that is computer science. Lot of questions are there. And I will just go for some quick questions are there, and some of them are little bit, I can say, some difficult or lengthy question. So let us see, will artificial intelligence ever attain self-awareness? This is one of the question. And some of the students, they have not given their name. Anonymous, they have asked. So this is, will artificial intelligence ever attain self-awareness?
Not like human beings, for sure. And that is, we should cherish off that AI will not replace us. Right? That's what also I tried to tell, that it is very similar and close to common sense kind of thing. Or self-awareness, which are the things, or influencing someone, which are the things which are extremely difficult by algorithms to learn, and human beings will be better off there.
Okay.
So that's a good thing in favor of human beings. Right?
Okay. So another question from some student, do you think AI in future will pose as a threat for unemployment in different fields like medicine and engineering? How can AI coexist in the future without increasing competition among people for job? So this is a job seeking student type of a question.
Yeah, I'm sure there are a lot of such questions. I'm seeing 135, and there are several of these which are very similar.
Yeah.
So let me give you some little bit elaborated answer on this for next 2 minutes.
Yeah.
You see, after AI, or because of technology and because of AI, there are five kinds of jobs will be in existence. Okay. First kind of job is strategic job. You decide a strategy in the sense which problem you would like to solve using AI, right? So strategic kind of jobs will be in existence. And I'm sure so several of the students know that, you know, the Western countries, the Google and other, you know, companies are very good at strategic management. They get the work done from Indian people, but they make money out of it there. That is a strategy because they know before that, that which kind of technology, which kind of solutions will be working in future. For example, Apple has developed a smartphone because they know that young kids will be addicted to that kind of smartphone, right? So that is a strategic kind of job. Second kind of job will be where, you know, you do something which computers are not good at, AI is not good at, which is emotional intelligence, or maybe I would say influencing others or clinching a deal. So this kind of jobs, computer will never be able to do, common sense, as you mentioned. So this is a second category of job, which will be existence in future. Don't forget, first was strategic decision. Second one was this. Third category of job where, you know, doing automation is costly. You cannot use computer, and that is very, very costly. There are a lot of examples there which have been taught in IIMs and all. One of the classical example is there's a person in Ahmedabad, as of now also, who buys, you know, Parle G biscuit in bulk and sells to the retailer at the same cost. So what is his profit? His profit is he sells the empty carton at 10,000 rupees a day to pastiwala.com. That is his business. Now in this business, there is no automation possible. If he does automation, he will lose the business. So that's the third category of job. Fourth category of job where, you know, you need to find out the mistakes in the computer algorithm using your common sense. Right? So there are several such, you know, examples again, whereby if you are a multimillionaire, but you lose your job for 3 months, let's say, and then you get some job which is of lesser payment compared to the previous one, your computer algorithm will reject your loan, even though you are a multimillionaire by default. So this is a mistake because there is no common sense in the computer algorithm. So that is the fourth category of job. And the last category is use AI, learn AI. So these five categories of jobs will never vanish. So nothing to worry. Only thing is there is a shift. If you know, in the schools, I'm sure Bloom's taxonomy is also taught, particularly to the teachers. There will be a shift from remembering things to maybe creating things. So there will be one step up in the Bloom's pyramid. That's only going to change. Otherwise, it's not going to. So in the shift, if I give an example earlier, if I want to take a passport, I need to consult an agent. Now it is online. Right? So there's a shift that, you know, one has to see. So these five categories of jobs will never vanish. So nothing to worry.
Okay, sir. Thank you. So I think the student is, he don't have to worry much about the job. He has to increase his competence to get a very good job. Now, the another question is, sir, I heard that the artificial intelligence is not possible nowadays. The system we use now, thinking as AI, is only stored information, including Sophia, the robot. She only has stored information. Is it true? That is the question.
No, what is that? Is it true?
That is what she is asking. That is the system we use now, thinking as AI, is only stored information. So we have stored information.
It's not a stored information at all. If it is stored information, it's just a memory which is infinite with the computer, but it is doing thinking like human beings. Not exactly same as that, but it has started doing that. The way in which human beings thinks, the computer algorithm also started thinking. So it is definitely not only a storing of the information. It is like correlating information. It is even creating new information by AI algorithm.
Okay. So one student is asking, that is very maybe 9th or 10th class student something, AI is similar to computer programming, or his another question, similar to question is, it is a Python language or some similar kind of language.
I purposefully did not touch that, but because the question has come, you know, in AI, the programming is very, very less, first thing. So if even if you are scared of programming, you can still learn AI because, you know, programming is a very high level. High level, I mean, very easy for the user. And of course, there is a de facto language right now used is Python language, which is extremely easy to learn. I would say 1/10 compared to C language, if you know C language, because I'm sure that in schools also C language are getting taught. But learning Python is like 1/10 efforts of C language. So it's easier to learn. So in 21st century, don't forget, solving a problem is not that difficult because tools are available like AI and Python and so many other things. But getting a right problem to solve is difficult. Getting a right problem to solve so that if you solve that, it becomes a product. So that is a challenge, right? So finding a right problem and solving them so that it becomes product is difficult compared to given a problem and solving that.
Okay. Sir, one student is asking, if robot does surgery on human being, it's so risky. If there is any problem on the robot, his or her life will be lost. So
that's true. That's true for a doctor also. So we cannot, you see, at least one thing is guaranteed, that if robot is achieving 99.9% accuracy, the robot will achieve that accuracy always. If doctor is achieving that accuracy, there is no guarantee that he will achieve the same accuracy always. Okay. So that way, definitely robots will be better. But in general, hardly any surgery will be performed without the assistance of a doctor. It will be always, last slide tells that it's always a joint venture, whereby a doctor will always control a robot and robot will do the surgery.
Okay.
But of course, based on that, I just should tell you that there are a lot of ethical issues here, a lot of legal related issues here, which is again opening up so many jobs. If there is a car, which is autonomous car, and if car knocks someone and somebody dies, who is going to be responsible? A car owner, a software engineer, or is an entire company who is selling a car? There are no answers in law. It means there are a large number of opportunities in law again because of AI. Right. So in general, jobs are not going to go at all. In fact, they are going to increase, but in different domains.
Sir, so I will go for last two questions, not more question. One question is, sir, how we can use AI to reduce the problem faced by worker in mines? Coal mines or some mines. Many mines workers died because of poisonous gas from inner earth. So
very good question.
How about a gadget working on AI help them to detect the presence of any toxic gases?
It's an excellent question. There are several ways. One way is deploying robots inside the mine, replacing the human being. Of course, it's a costly affair, but that is one solution. Second solution is, which we are even working, so that's what I appreciate that question as well, whereby you can put a lot of sensors inside the mine, and when there is hazardous gas is coming out, it can predict before time using artificial intelligence, and it can be evacuated. So all can come out before that effect goes and they are affected because of that. So both the solutions are definitely and easily possible using AI.
So I will go for the last question. Sir, as Stephen Hawking said that if artificial intelligence gains consciousness, it will evolve faster than human, who takes millions of years to evolve just a bit and threat human-like animal. So what are your views? So this is not a question, they are thus wanted to...
Yeah, say remark. So we hope ideally that it should not achieve that as a human being, that no machine should surpass us. Otherwise, we have seen in movies like robots and all what it can do, which kind of harm it can do. And for that, you know, there are a lot of attempts have been done at international level as well. And there was a extraordinary conference in India on responsible AI with our prime ministers inaugurated last month. It was a fantastic conference. It was only on combining AI with humanities and social science so that any algorithm, any software, any robots which is made using AI will have ethics inside it, right? So that it will not go against the human being. So that's one more step. So I feel the statement should not be true in the sense that it should not achieve that kind of expertise so that it will go against the human being.
Okay, sir. Sir, very much thank you from my side and whole team, Student Science Village. And I am really sorry from the student size. There are so many questions, as you see. And
yeah, I can due see 194.
Yeah, so. Due to time limitation, we cannot take all the questions. So maybe some of the question will answer and put on the some platform of IISF. That is the IISF 2020 platform. And there also for Student Science Village, there is a mass email is given. They can send their questions and we will direct to the experts for their expert answer.
Sure.
This lecture is actually very, very good. I have learned a lot and my student has also learned a lot. Thank you for this lecture and giving time for so basic thing about artificial intelligence that is really helped them a lot. Now,
thank,
I would like to
thank Dr. Sudhakar, Dr. Ayas.
Yeah, I will request Dr. Saeed Rais sir, to please come up and give vote of thanks to sir for his kind contribution in Science Village, Student Science Village. Rais sir.
Sir, it has been a great privilege to listen to you. And I was continuously watching there are not more than 200 questions are there. That shows the keen interest of the students and the other participants who are, been listening to your lecture very seriously. And all time 650 participants were there. And this particular topic now is catching up all over the globe, all over the country, as you have rightly shown from the Google founder and others, that how much leap and bounds it is going to grow.
Yes.
And particularly in India, where we have a lot of challenges in each sector, and AI is going to play a major role. And your lecture will go in a big way to sensitize our students and teachers and other faculties to take forward this agenda. And on behalf of IISF organizing committee, on behalf of our own Student Science Village, I would like to extend our sincere thanks and gratefulness to you, sir, for sparing your valuable time.
It's my pleasure.
Been extremely useful to all of us. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you.
Thank you.